Electronic copies of all these things that have been on display.
Yes.
Sent to us.
Yes, we can. We'll pop it up on our website and I'll send the link to all the attendees.
Thank you.
Beautiful. So,
what was the question?
You're all going to have access to all of the presentations, which is wonderful because there was so much information. Yes.
Yeah. How best or what options are there for controlling grassy weed species in an establishing native grass site?
Grassy weed species in a native grass stand. How do I control the bloody things? Yeah, thank you. You got that? Grassy weeds in the grass stand?
Yes, and I was going to ask that as well. Can I put an addendum onto that? Including things like Vulpia, which are resistant to grass selective herbicides.
Right.
Okay,
so you got that, Chris?
Yep.
Does fungal inoculation have a place? Establishing new grass.
Lovely. A whole new field.
Excellent.
We'll definitely be getting that for that tomorrow. Yeah.
And mosses and lichens as well.
What do you want to do with the mosses and lichens?
Adding them to or is there some way to...
You want them within the ecosystem.
Add that crossing to the top.
Because it's good? Yes, not bad. Yeah. Other stuff? Why you all came? There's not many people that want to know anything. But at least you do.
What can we do when all you've got is yourself and bullies and no budget?
What can you do when you've got no budget and no volunteers? Probably one very simple answer to that, but I'm not going to tell you.
You have volunteers.
How many volunteers? No budget. Good. Okay. You've got it. You have got volunteers and they're willing, but yeah, there's nothing to sustain you.
On that question, how do we get value put into the industry so that even though there's not much economic returns, that the money's been put in to restore biodiversity and things like that, which has so much value, even though it's not an economic value? How do we go about changing the regime where we get funding?
We get funded for doing this because it's good.
Yeah, but more money.
More money,
because at the moment the value isn't recognised in the industry from a federal or government point of view. They go, well, yeah, but you're going to get, you know, we've got fighter jets to buy, things like that. We can't afford to pay for restoration projects. How do we change that regime to getting the value in these projects from the biodiversity stuff recognised? Mm-hmm.
Sounds a bit political to me.
It's a social thing.
Yeah, can we still have our submarines?
No. You wouldn't have questions on that.
Yeah.
I was listening to seed testing options for us, for the people purchasing seed.
So what should be the things which, you know, what we...
You've got
a certification slip saying you get...
A list of the... laboratories or the commercial entities in the north for us.
There's only really one.
The Pasco one that you always see on Chris Finlay's seed test.
Yeah, which is pretty much, as far as I'm taking, more agricultural.
Yeah, exactly.
I've basically started mine up so I can service SA, Victoria, New South Wales, all the eastern states. Western Australia have a lot more.
Yeah.
Or it's developing a lot more rapidly over there, but I'll come back so that I can service people here.
And the problem with using an agricultural vet, which is what I've done in the past, is we had Subrector that we had actually supplied for a project and sent off to, and they just did a tetrazolium test on it. No viable seed. And the client said, well, what do you want to do with it? And I said, well, we might as well sell it out. We've got it. Oh, lo and behold, Atroplex Subrector came up. They just didn't understand. The problem with agricultural labs is they're used to dealing with agricultural seeds and not with native seed biology, and that's why people like Alice and there's a whole crew with Jason over in Kings Park that are native seed biology experts.
I'm supposed to hear that because I thought of my inability to use the internet.
No, it's just a developing niche at the moment. So Western Australia really at the forefront. I'm trying to get it up and going for eastern states.
And there's some great seed testing over in WA, but you're getting stuff over there is a pain because of all
the quarantine issues.
But on your website, you've got minimum.
I don't have a website yet.
Have you got a busy now?
I only moved back to SA about a year and a half ago.
Minimum sample size, cost of analysis, blah blah blah.
Yeah.
Normally
what I do is I basically just get people to send me what species is that they want to test and stuff like that, and then I'll send individual quotes so that I can actually, because especially with germination tests, if I know that a particular species is more likely to have less wild seeds or less seed fall, I might actually increase the sample size so that I can actually cater and get realistic results, because if you say have a species that you know is probably going to have low seed fill, and you test say 200 florets and really only maybe 50 are actually potentially germinable, it's not a very big sample size. So I like to cater my quotes specifically for the species that people want.
Well, it's controversial seeing as other people in the room, but if your seed harvesting's done at a day rate, rush harvesters, or you're spending, or you're buying seed per kilogram,
yes,
and your day rates are much less than your kilogram rates, you can still have a 50% reduction in viability and still get more seed, because you're economically, your day rates, you're getting all the seed harvested off that day rate. And if it's a good season, you're going to win. If it's a bad season, you've got to go back to the irrigated crops like Flora Vicks. So we need, as a purchaser, we need to know all that.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, even though I test seeds, I don't condone the, you know, like some of the stuff that I've tested for Crystal and for Tim and stuff. I've actually gone, well, this is, you know, it might look like it's low seed fill or low viability, but in the context of that species, it's actually pretty reasonable. But I have a pretty good knowledge of where things should be just from, you know, the several hundred species I've tested over the years.
Can we park that as something that maybe the group could facilitate through the website?
Yeah.
Because at least the group has a website that's rolling.
I don't want to destroy anyone's
involvement. So maybe some contacts?
No, you can go on the website if you want. Known seed germination mobility labs that do specialise in indigenous species.
Yeah, that's basically it. So I don't really know anyone else doing it over there, so.
Okay, here we go again.
Thinking about re-establishing grasslands from a biodiversity point of view, at what point do we need to concede that some of the exotic species will become part of those ecosystems? I know it's not nice to think about, but is that inevitable?
Yeah, when you actually give up.
Yeah.
but I mean, if you think of agriculture and how, you know, Salvation Jane used to be a terrible thing, and you know, people just hated it. I have a friend who used to pay, I think it's a dollar for every plant that his daughter pulled out. She was a rich girl, actually, but you know how it sort of. It's now fizzled out pretty much as a really bad thing on the plains because of all of them, a lot of the parasites and so on. But a lot of us had kind of given up on trying to control it, but maybe there's other ways of getting at some of these things. So as part of a whole ecological approach, maybe there's ways that we can tolerate some of those baddies and let the apiarists have their home.
Maybe it's a question about what species you're prepared to tolerate, maybe.
Yeah.
I don't know if I'm correct, but there might be some species that, you know,
you can't quite think of it, like, oh, gosh. Some species you can better tolerate to
something, you know, like, you know, rather
than
say, no,
it's not making them like it up. What species or what levels of species? Yeah. Okay. That's, you know, you're looking at sort of like invertebrates now, sort of, I suppose, with the, you know, starting to use other sort of host plants, like, I suppose the native Proctalis as opposed to the feral one, you know, Proctalis funiculata,
chicken.
Host plant. You know, so I suppose a lot of crops, you know, native biodiversity, if you like, they've already sort of started to, you know, I suppose, have sort of, you know, reduce other sort of forms.
You know, this is the key, is for biodiversity or for habitat, then are we removing all these buildings, are we just shooting ourselves for
Yeah, we have some things that we've had fun with our betons, which actually love scarcell bowls, and of course in terms of an agricultural sort of slash biodiverse environment, that's a pretty good sort of relationship with that. Okay, now of course, yes, dear Amy.
Grazing management has been mentioned in the management tool, but what are ideal grazing regimes for native grasslands?
Yeah, great question. Maybe let's address that, because we've got some good people here that do write that very thing.
I was going to say, in Western Australia, where we've got recruitment, a lot of native grasses back in other systems.
Yeah,
might be
fodder.
Might be fodder-based systems, or they might be in amongst alleys or, say, alley trees. We've got pretty good recruitment of native grasses, and they're not actually sown. But the way they react to grazing, they seem to fit the, you know, large numbers of sheep for a short period of time, and you get it out, the whole system sort of recovers over a period of a year, and they go back in again. But you need, you know, reasonably large land holdings to do that, or small so, which way you are, but yeah, that sort of crash grazing with significant numbers of sheep seems to work pretty well.
But it would also come back to your moisture grass, the moisture availability for that particular season and its nutrient availability. Obviously in dry climates you're not going to be able to put as many sheep as what you would be able to on the Thoreau Peninsula, for example, because the grass has got more chance to recover after a grazing period. So it's going to be site and species specific. This is the problem with anything we do with this, is it's, you've got to look at everything on a case by case basis. We can't give you a prescriptive thing for restoration of grassland, management of grassland. It's going to be different from season to season to site to site.
Do you want to say when in the cycle that you've obviously got your plant growing and it's going to come up the head and so forth, when's the best time to actually whack your sheep in?
Anytime. Yeah. Like, depends on what you're going. You know, if you're a producer, it's about production. So, you know, but if your goal is, you know, that's what you need to work out. You know, what is our goal here? You know? So, ultimately, for better biodiversity, better recruitment, we would take them out in that window where they're growing to go to seed, to predict where they're seeding. So that window, October, depending on whether you're on the peninsula, sort of taken up, and then, you know, across to November, December, depending on your rainfall and your season. But then this year, you know, we've got stipers flowering about 2 weeks ago, so you would have had that in September. So exactly what Tim is saying, it depends on the season. But my philosophy is any rest is better than no rest. So rather than go to set stocking where you've got sheep in that paddock 365 days of the year, or 360 where they come out for shearing and then go back to the same paddock, any rest is better than none. Higher intensity, short duration, so I'm talking 25 plus DSC, dry sheep equivalents for each day, at least for a short period of time. And again, it's going to depend on how much biomass you've got and where you're situated. But we're talking about high intensity, we're not talking about three sheep per hectare, we're talking about high for short periods of time.
I tend to agree on experiencing WA is the same. It's large numbers of sheep for a short period of time. And it also depends a bit on not just the climate and what you're growing, but also the enterprise you're dealing with. You know, lots of lakes will have, you know, that warm feed gap. So that's the sort of holy grail if you can fill that sort of feed gap. But other people have other strategies to deal with that warm feed gap. So kind of depends a bit on the enterprise as well as to how you're grazing and native pastures fit into the overall business model of an enterprise.
There's a whole host of fact sheets and information out
there. Is there anyone here with practical experience in managing assisted livestock at all? No?
The Evergrey series. Evergreys.
Evergreys.
Evergreys. There's a leaflet debate about Alan.
Just be cautious. Evergreys. I just like want to mention there's a whole host of stuff, fantastic stuff, and I look, you know, there's a whole heap of stuff that comes from the eastern states. Just sort of like just put your court, just be cautious about taking, you know, you're dealing with a lot more dominant C4 pastures, some are active pastures, and we do have C4s in a lot of our systems, but they're dealing with much more C4 dominated pastures and also their rainfall distribution. So fantastic stuff's coming out of that, but just make sure it fits your local environment would be my idea, cautious. And that's, I think, why, you know, as part of that strategy, we produced a whole heap of stuff in South Australia because of those issues. So, and there's more and more stuff coming out all the time.
Jodie, does the North Grasslands Working Group have any publications?
Yeah. North Grasslands Working Group have a whole host of publications.
So they online? They're,
Very soon they will be. Their website's down at the moment, but the process of bringing that back up. So, yeah.
Maybe you can let the group know. Yeah. So if we just push that out to everybody.
As far as the forestry group, guys have already have also done a work on that. They're on the website and studies as well.
Improved grazing group. We have a website. Wonderful. Now, other things that people need to know. Glenn.
Mr. Schubel, we need to the top two. Is there a little path going on in native grasses? I'm positive. Planners have had observations of remnant grass stands with no weeds, weeds fall around and not germinate in the remnant stand. I think my neighbour might be able to speak to some of that.
Right, anyone there want to handle the concept of a little bit happy? No. Shall we park it? Time being? Yep. Okay, let's go on. Yep.
I just asked Tim about the Northern Expressway. You know, you started at that. Was it 6 years ago? No,
2008, the project started from memory, and then we set up a seed production area because the transport department wanted to sow native grass seeds, and originally they wanted just to include a native grass component in with their exotic grass mix. And I said, well, there's no point to that. I said, if you're better off having discrete areas, and then you'll know whether it's been successful or not. So we planted bluegrass and things like that down in the detention basins, which was quite successful. And just had some native grass areas along it, and some mainly kinopods, form and herb seeded areas as well.
Yeah.
And I can't remember how many hectares, I think it's about 12 hectares or something like that out of the 120, or whatever it was.
And did you do a site assessment of that, you know, like looking at soil, compactions?
No, I didn't, and that's and that's one thing that's been highlighted, and comes back to what Chris and other people have said today, is, you know, getting some idea of what the soils are about. I was over in Western Australia last month for their revegetation industry seminar, and the guy from the transport department there was presenting on there a project called Gateway. There's some pretty big road projects over in Western Australia. And they went through and classified all their soils that they were going to use, or potentially use, and they decided only to use pristine or very high quality soils in terms of weed loads and nutrients and things like that. Back in the landscape, everything else got sent off somewhere else or buried or whatever, because they just didn't want to have to spend huge amounts of money managing that and then have it all go weedy when the project finishes, there's no funding available. So that's one big thing that, especially through the Adelaide Plains there, as I said, it's either agricultural or market garden lands, and we just had a lot of problems. We had some success, we had a little failure as well, we don't know. The seed was fine, we got that to work, but it's just
I'm just wondering whether you go back and sort of looked at, you know, the site and assess it for that sort of knowledge, or, you know, that idea that, you know, what hasn't worked as much as maybe that gives you a bit more sort of
Well, I'm a practitioner, so I like to try and lead up the science nerds to go and do that. Just like, you know, the seed testing. Here you go, Alice. You can sit there with your microscope. Come and get some pieces to do.
Burning question. that it's sort of been addressed by some of you at this time. So we've got this tiny little seat, you know, about the size of a pinhead, that we're trying to get into an environment which is often, as Jody's saying and Jason's saying, pretty hostile sort of stuff. And so, you know, do we try and plant as a naked carry hopsis, or do we leave the seed coat on? There's been, you know, various discussions about that. Do we broadcast? And Chris is saying, you know, broadcast and we'll drill itself in and look after itself, as far as hydrological requirements go. Or do we try and get it, you know, 5 mils below the soil surface with some sort of precision seeding in order to try and make this whole exercise for the broader scale more cost effective? What is the best approach?
Some extent, because if you get some instant success, but then I also believe that yeah, maybe we should actually leave some of the soil so that they can be in the bank and they will come out of their dormancy cycle at some point. But, you know, they've evolved to have those mechanisms to deal with our environment.
I love the shield shrimp, which lives on top of Uluru, and the shield shrimps have a very short lifespan, as you can imagine. There's not usually a hell of a lot of water up there. And the ones that have been born as a result of proper sexual contact between their parents have an egg that's quite hard and reasonably water repellent. So that takes quite a bit of water, quite a long kind of immersion, whereas those eggs that are popped out like lightning by the female without active fertilisation by the male kind of germinate almost straight away. And so maybe priming half of your seed might be a way to go, and as you say, having a bit each way.
The problem with that argument, if I like, is that, as Jason showed, even if you go through priming processes, all the seed treatment processes, you don't take that seed to 100% germination. You still take it to maybe a 30 or 40% germination. What you've done is take it from might have been 10% germ at the time, up to 30 or 40. You've still got 40 to 60% of the seeds not that didn't germinate back at that time. So,
it depends on the species.
It's not shifting to 100%, you're just taking it up higher. And you're increasing the percentage that will actually germinate. You're still leaving it there with that.
One thing that many years ago, before I probably started doing any of my native grass work, one thing that he said stuck in my head is we see soil contact as paramount. So any of the direct seeding I've done, whether it's been hand broadcasting, I've run a machine on afterwards to sort of incorporate the seed into the top part of the soil, or I've had press wheels or rollers and some of the seeders I had there, all these different press wheels, because want to anchor the seed in the seed soil contact, and you also want to anchor it so it doesn't blow away, especially for some of these lighter species. So that's just the approach I've taken.
There's a fair bit of work around clays, and there's a lot of work coming out of the US now where they're looking at other substrates in around the coats. Again, we've gone down a polymer coating pathway. That's a piece of people backtracking as well. They're thinking in other compounds easily around seed.
It's often, sometimes when you go to workshops and conferences, you get some sort of flying at, the ants really, coat the seed or and, you really do need to put a whole package and some sort of, hang and mix the whole strategy together to get a good establishment package. And know how it has to change. Often, recipe doesn't work if you don't know how to change it. And you need to have these sort of overall sort of principles and then know what parts to change over what conditions and how you might address those issues.
Like any great chef.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Know how to do it and throw the book away.
Often there's a bit of science, but there's also a lot of experience and a bit of art in all of this sort of thing.
From the scientist, yes.
Regarding the fungal inoculation, considering some resources say between 95% of plant species have mycorrhizal fungal relationships, how can we incorporate that in our grass and such?
Guys, you guys.
I mean, people have tried to put things into plants. Sorry, yeah, but I guess in the seed coating world, people have looked at rhizobia in that space. Mycorrhizal associated with the long term with incorporating the coats to make a better experience.
There was a commercial, acacia based horse, I can't remember what it was called, when that company was taken over, because the volumes weren't there compared to, say, all the other agricultural. They just dropped it.
What species that have mycorrhizal association? But anyway, perhaps not to be too clever, pardon me, because I do my stuff in a petro system where if we're taking what happens in the field, put it in the tub, and you make it work for you in a way that natives decompose. And that just creates the, well, the bugs, whatever, that work out in the field for you in the tub. Take them out, put them back in the field, and they've been nurtured for quite a while, and that's, I've done some things that work. And if you know what you're doing, eventually, if you have to do it better, it's a useful way of doing it. You can have to do it by knowing what to buy and putting the soil on brand to see. You can do it quite easily.
Can I just quickly add one on that? Not that I've been directly involved in this project, but the mining project that I'm involved with, some of the researchers from Federation Uni, what they did is they wanted to do a biocrust trial. So what they essentially did is just go out to the remnant areas, shovel up soil and sieve it out, spread it out, and then mix it up with tank, the psyllium husk, and then spray that out on the ground. And it's so far, it's actually demonstrated that you can get some of this biocrust back on it. So it's just, yeah.
Do you have a comment
on
that?
Yeah, more. I guess this is going to be a topic for tomorrow, my talk, and I think Ashland's talk as well. And I guess there's still a lot of work to do to get it to the application. You can't just deal with the, we don't really know what the natives rely on, so that's some of the work that I've been doing, some genetic stuff. So we need to know what micro communities they need, and we also found that a lot of the remnant micro communities are currently cultured, so doing it on a large scale isn't quite there yet. But there are things that you can be doing by only taking a small amount of soil from a remnant area, and putting that in the tube stocks, for instance, and then that's over several months that the culture can grow, you don't need very much, and then as those plants get planted out, then they'll have the microbes with them. But yeah, still a lot of work to do, and how those microbes will compete with the very degraded area and the other microbes and other things in there. So yeah, it's something definitely need to work on, and it's being done in small amounts.
In the nurseries in WR, I'm interested in Frankie, which grows with casuarinas and things. And of course you can't go and buy Frankie that occurs in WI, so what we did for that nursery, we set up a culture system. So over several generations, got a nice culture within some large, you know, big tubs. They were growing the sheoaks in, and then they'd use, harvest the Frankie nodules from that stock plants, and then irrigate over their tube stock before they went out into the fields. So Frankia is some other, I don't know exactly what is it.
Actually, that probably works better as well.
But you could use that approach if you had some that you can't culture, but you know, say you've got a bank, so you know it's mycorrhizal. Can't grow it in a culture system. You might grow it in like a sand culture, in a thick tub, and then you make sure that substrate is disease free, and then you can use that to inoculate your plant to that way. It's a different way of going about it, and it does work really well for the Shia team. They work exceptionally well.
Right. Wayne Brown shows some photographs of eminently local on the freeway near Bridgewood. And they do that very, very well with the highways department taking out of Western Australian gravidia. And so the gravidia plants will be dug out, we planted them somewhere else, like you're saying, and cultivated that whatever they produce, would be work very well. Like our point for this too.
Yes. And then you get over the disease issue. You go and take that soil sample from a bush or something, you might have other diseases that you do more harm than good, but if you have a cultivation type system,
and be careful, colonists prevention
was being the coding for a sea, IT sonar sea with a polymer and Pikmin water. And I'm pretty sure that actually picked up antagonistic species of aquaculture that actually killed my seagulls. And it's been quite realised to have a patch of about several metres long, they all died, and then stopped that study again. So there's one little thing happening in the soil, those microbes that help us all in us.
Indeed. Now, any more issues that we need to pop on the board?
Seed.
In one particular respect?
Every aspect.
Every aspect.
There's so many aspects we can do with the light and grass and everything. But that viability, the number of species that are available, the disturbances. Anyone else could probably add to that if there's a whole host of seed related aspects.
Yes, just I guess following on from that, for me it's just understanding the scale of it.
Industry for 20 years now, and I'm fortunate that I mostly work for one mining project, and we have a requirement to supply seed for around about between 100 and 150 hectares of rehabilitation year, which equates to about 1.5 tonnes,
yep,
just for the project. So I know I've got that each year. Obviously, I've got all the seasonal problems and things with that, but I used to work around here, and you know, especially with Glenn from Succession Ecology, and it's just such a hit and miss market. One that Jody says, oh, we don't have enough seed. Well, that's, I understand that, but I'm not just going to go and collect it and put it on the shelf. I've had people go, oh, do you want to, it's great year for stipend, do you want to go and buy a ton? I can get a ton. Well, I haven't got anyone to sell it to either. You know, it's a supply and demand thing, and it's just investment. I know Glenn tries to stock up with quite a bit of native grass now, because he's, in past years, he knows he's sold it, but it's just making that commitment, because you've got to, you know, you've got the labour and all the investment of collecting and storing and things like that for something that, and then we've got other issues with storage bubble. The native grass not so much a problem, but we discovered that we've been doing some long-term testing of this project we only started 2 years ago with the mining project, and Alice has just done the second lot of testing a couple of months ago, and a couple of key Mariana species we use, Mariana servilia, the bluebush, and Mariana pyramidata, black bluebush, they green embryos and 50% viability loss after 18 months. So we can't store those long term, we've got to collect them fresh each year, so there's a big implication for us for that. So if you're a seed producer and you're just storing stuff, again, I think native grasses are fairly fine, but if you're fine, but a lot of the other forbs and herbs, who knows what the storage life of those things are, you've got all those sitting on the shelf for 5 or 6 years and someone says, oh, I want to buy them, and then they get them tested and go, well, they're no good, well,
That's a real world example of backing up on tip. I would collect the last couple of years 200 kilos and say down 30 per year. I'll have orders for 100, and I know that 100 will sell, but I chew my nails coming up to May, and then Sean Kennedy starts ringing me. And other people. So it always sells, but your nerve and your appetite for risk. And I fully back up what Tim is saying there. It is a chicken and the egg thing, and it's to your level of risk that you want to take. And I think, Ian, you might have had some comment on that. You collect more than you need, you know it's going to sell, but you're going to have moments where you think, have I overcommitted?
I'm actually only 25 years old, but I look at Albert.
Could you say you suffer from mental torment?
The seed production zone, without the context from the ideal consumer tells you in advance and they're going to give you money up front for all this. We don't have that. We don't have that system at all. So we really have to take a punt. And we have a number of 29 different grass lines we're producing seed.
Who doesn't like, everyone wants certainty.
I mean, yeah, it's a very market-driven world, and it's like, when you think of diseases and immunisations and things as well. Like, say, I think it was the Ebola recently. That's been around for years, but until it became a big issue, there wasn't much money or investment spent on finding the solution. So with seed ecology and all the traits and that, research takes money and, finding solutions take money, but unless there's the driver who has the money to do those investments in the market for it, all the time it just sits there and we acknowledge there's the problems, but nothing gets done about it.
The issues are the same for, say, like the subtropical grasses as well. When the evergreen really started to crank on, and they could, agricultural sense, show that, having grown these in Mediterranean climates was actually quite productive. There was big demand, but then that waned, and seed production was a massive issue. So it's not saying it's just unique to the native grasses.
Hey, Chris, this is your first comment for the day.
That talk is stuff that Paul Gibson brought in and brought back to the United States. And three out of the four categories in almost everything is driven by government regulation and the outcomes from that. I mean, in Australia, it'll be driven by mining companies doing offsets and all sorts of other people required to do major offsets. I mean, that's what drives things, essentially. There's millions of dollars involved in that. We've seen the figures.
That's what my work's driven from.
Exactly. Concentrating, sort of, I said, I suppose, politically in ways, on getting those sort of mechanisms in place is a key to driving the whole process. And also, like WA, not letting them mess.